Acts chapter 1 is where we're at tonight. Let's say a prayer before we start. Lord, we thank you so much for your word, knowing that you know better than we do about what we should be doing and what is important. And help us to focus our attention tonight on your will. And as we learn about the early time of the apostles of your kingdom, help us understand what they were doing and why, to help guard us against the errors and following a pattern that you've not given us. So we thank you for your grace and your pattern you've applied to us through the Apostle Paul. Amen. Okay, the book of Acts. Last week we gave the introduction to the book, and I hope that was helpful to give a bird's eye view of what the book is about. Okay, the book of Acts, just in a quick review, is not the beginning of the church. And in our series that we go through here for the next chapters, hopefully we'll see that clearly. We're going to cover the first 8 or 9 chapters of the book. The book of Acts is a bridge. At the beginning of the book, as we'll see tonight, we see Christ giving a commission, instructions to the apostles to Israel to preach a message about him being the Christ and the restitution of the kingdom and things like that. By the end of the book of Acts, in the very last chapter even, you have Paul saying to Jews as far away as Rome, salvation is not going to you anymore. Right, so there's a clear conclusion to this book that at the beginning, salvation was being offered, the kingdom was being offered to Israel. At the end, it is no longer going there. Without this book, then, we would not understand what happened between Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and the book of Romans and Paul's ministry and what our pattern is. Because of that, because of the confusion in the book, people often go back to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John because when choosing between Jesus or Paul, they're going to choose Jesus. So they go back to Jesus' ministry and they try to follow that pattern there, not knowing that the Lord Jesus himself has given Paul as a pattern, given him a message to give to us. And so we are to follow his pattern. The book of Acts explains that eventually. So that's where we're at. So let's start in verse by verse tonight in Acts chapter 1, verse 1, where we established last week that Luke is the author of the book based on verse 1, where he says, "The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus." And so we compared that to Luke 1, verses 1 through 3, and how Luke says the same thing there, writing to Theophilus, and the intent there to write was that he would have an understanding of all the things that they knew about Christ from the beginning. And so we also covered that Luke and Acts were the longest books of the New Testament, which kind of show not only Luke's long-windedness, but more his purpose, which was to explain all of these things. It was not simply to give a proof of Jesus as the Son of God, as John was, or to give an explanation of Christ as the King to Israel and Matthew. It was to explain to someone, maybe a new believer, all of the events that had transpired in Jesus' ministry. Okay, and so we see that in Acts 1, verse 1, where he says, "I wrote to you, Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach." So that all there is underlined, right? Of all. That's why the books are so long. But also, notice it says all that Jesus began both to do and teach. So he says that former book, that former treatise I wrote, that's the book of Luke, 24 chapters, that was the beginning, which is fascinating because at the end of the book, Jesus dies. And, you know, of course, in the first chapter here, he leaves. And so we might think, oh, that's the end of Jesus' ministry. You know, he was born in Luke chapter 2 and 3. He died in Luke 24. He's gone. That's it. Well, Luke's making the point. No, that's not it. That's the beginning. You see, he resurrected from the dead. And so this book of Acts is going to be the continuation of Jesus' ministry. And we'll see that first, in the first half, through the apostles that he chose in his earthly ministry, the 12 apostles, but then later through that one apostle that he chooses to be the apostle of the Gentiles. Every apostle in the book of Acts, the Lord Jesus Christ ordains to be an apostle. So he's continuing his ministry, you see, through the book. So Luke says, all that Jesus began both to do and teach here. And then in verse 2, until the day in which he was taken up. And so Luke 24, of course, ends with Jesus' commission to the apostles while they're eating there. And then in Acts 1, the very first thing that happens in this chapter, we'll cover probably next week, is the ascension, the day that he was taken up into heaven. Okay, and so he says, I told you before all the beginning until the day in which he was taken up. And then he says, after that, he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen. So that is the book of Acts right there. Before, he was talking about the beginning, what Jesus began to do and to teach. And then he says, after that, he, Jesus, through the Holy Ghost, gave commandments to the apostles. That's the book of Acts. That's what it's about. So after Jesus' earthly ministry in the beginning, he also instructed and commanded through these apostles. So important. When people say, what would Jesus do, for example? They always go back to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John because those are red letters in your Bible, right? Those are the words that Jesus spoke. Well, Acts 1 verse 2 says Jesus spoke things through the Holy Ghost to apostles in this book, right? So the apostles, as they're speaking the book of Acts, that's Jesus as well, you see. So we need to recognize that. Some people try to do that when they follow Peter as their pattern, you know, and they listen to what Peter's preaching in Acts 2 and saying, that's what we need to do. Well, keep reading in the book of Acts and you see the Lord Jesus Christ appeared to Paul and gave him words to speak. And we recognize that Paul's words are also the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. That'll change the way you think about the Bible, okay? And so we need to understand that the Lord is ministering in the book of Acts through the Holy Ghost. That's the first time we see that phrase Holy Ghost that appears some 50 times in this book. Of course, specifically here in verse 2, he's talking about those apostles, those 12 apostles that he chose in his earthly ministry. Luke, by the way, is the only gospel writer that spends some time identifying when the Lord or how the Lord chose these disciples. In Matthew and Mark and John, it just kind of mentions their names. You know, the disciples started following and they mentioned the names. But in Luke, I believe it's Luke chapter 6, verse 13 or thereabouts, it says, he called all the disciples to him, and then he, out of them, chose 12 to be apostles. And it's the same thing here where Luke again says, of the apostles whom he had chosen. So that's interesting. In case you're not aware, hopefully you are, those 12 men that Jesus chose, and he said in John 6, one of them is a devil, of those men that he chose on purpose. He chose for a function. And it was not just because this is how you start a church. You need 12 men. It's divisible by two. You know, this, it was 12 men to rule over 12 tribes of Israel. And so he chose those men for a purpose to be apostles. They were not just the most spiritual men or those that were the most friendly to the Lord. They were given a specific office, okay? So there was a choosing there from the Lord. The apostles here, that word is also a pretty good definition in this verse. People ask, what is an apostle? You know, am I an apostle? Well, this verse talks about apostles whom he had chosen. So what is an apostle? Well, it's someone that God chooses and sends with a commission. Sends with a mission, okay? And that's what we're going to see here, where Jesus spoke in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in the so-called Great Commissions. He was speaking to these men. He wasn't speaking to the whole nation of Israel or even to all of his followers. He appeared to those men and gave them the instructions because he chose them to be those leaders, those apostles, to do that. So we are not apostles today, because we specifically, individually, have not been chosen by the Lord and given a specific individual message. We are not the first to do that. We've received this message from men before us and more primarily from our Apostle Paul, you know, from the letters he wrote that the Lord sent him to write. And so we are not apostles. These guys are apostles. God chose them and sent them with a mission directly. Okay, that's a pretty good definition, I think. Let's move on to verse 3. It says, to whom also, to these apostles, he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days. This is a fascinating verse here because it tells us quite a few things about what happened after Jesus rose from the dead. Unlike the Mel Gibson movie, The Passion, where it ends with his death and it doesn't include the resurrection, and a lot of those Christian movies talking about the Gospels do that. They don't talk much about the resurrection because Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John doesn't either. You know, it kind of ends with that and it's kind of an afterthought. But Acts here starts with that and says, well, the first thing we're talking about is how Jesus was alive and he showed himself alive to these apostles, these disciples for 40 days. And so that kind of reminds, or at least it should, of 1 Corinthians 15. Remember 1 Corinthians 15 where Paul is defending the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ to the Corinthians? And he explains and he gives proofs in this verse of how we know Christ rose from the dead. And 1 Corinthians 15 verse 4 says, the gospel that whereby you're saved is that he died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12, and after that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present. But some are fallen asleep. After that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles. And last of all, he was seen of me also, as one born out of due time. So here's a list of eyewitness testimony that Paul gives of Jesus Christ's resurrection. And this is not, These aren't the blurry, fuzzy pictures of UFOs you see flying in the sky. And this is not Bigfoot sightings. You know, these are people who not only saw him, but saw him multiple times and spoke with him and assembled with him and ate with him. I mean, he was living with them. You see, this was not, oh, I think we see Jesus over there. These are eyewitnesses. And Luke says there's infallible proofs. Paul says there's over 500 men that's seen him. Now, Paul himself is a pretty good proof of Christ's resurrection. Being the only apostle, an apostle being one that the Lord chooses and sends a mission with, being the only apostle that was ordained after Christ's resurrection, that didn't know Christ before. The 12 apostles were chosen of Christ before he died. And so you may argue, even though it's not true and very weak argument, you could say, well, these guys, they were just trying to perpetuate the Lord's ministry, this guy that they loved after he died. But what about Paul? He was persecuting Peter's group. And then suddenly, 180, he's preaching Christ's resurrection, his death and resurrection for salvation, him being a devout Jew of the law of blameless, and now he's preaching Christ's resurrection. How did that happen? Paul is the apostle of the resurrection. His salvation by itself is testimony of Christ's resurrection from the dead. Okay, but besides that, Paul gives 500 other guys who were alive at the time. So he says, you don't believe me, talk to any of these 500 guys. They've all seen him. Okay, and they're alive. So if Paul's a liar, all those guys are liars. You say, well, what's 500 witnesses? 500 witnesses. That's a lot more than witness many historical events that we just take for granted. For example, every Thanksgiving, we celebrate what? The pilgrims coming over from England and landing on Plymouth Rock, right? Now, there's some debate about whether there's a literal rock there or not, but of course they all came over, right? Mayflower and all that business, the Magna Carta, right? There's only 100 people on those boats. Only 100 people witnessed the Magna Carta and those boats landing on America and living there. William Bradford wrote about the events. Was he lying? How do we believe this man? He wrote about these events with 100 people witnessing what happened there and how they tried to practice Acts 2 and communism, and wasn't communism at the time. They tried to redistribute their wealth like in Acts 2, and it failed miserably. And so then the next year they had private property, and then they succeeded in their gardening. But how do you know any of that's true? There was only 100 people. There are more than 500 people that witnessed Christ's resurrection. How many people were in the theater when Abraham Lincoln got shot? How do you know that he was actually shot? What, maybe his wife shot him. Maybe his friend shot him. How do you know who shot Abraham Lincoln? Well, there's only a couple hundred people there. You know, if that. 500 people plus was eyewitness testimony of Christ's resurrection, and multiple times he appeared to them, right? I bring that up just to show you that there is abundant evidence of Christ's resurrection, not the least of which God's word says it happened. Okay, it prophesied it would happen. It happened. Jesus said it would happen. It happened. And your salvation depends upon it, which is Paul's argument in 1 Corinthians 15. If you didn't rise from the dead, you're still yet in your sins. We talked about it on Sundays, Romans 6, 7, and 8. If Christ didn't raise from the dead, you can't claim to be in Christ. You can't claim to be saved by grace. You can't claim any of that, right? His resurrection's crucial for that. So there's a multitude of evidences for Christ's resurrection. Of course, you have the empty tomb and those sort of things where they haven't found the body and all that. But in Acts chapter 1, verse 3, notice the words that Luke uses here. He says that Christ showed himself alive after his passion. By the way, this is the only time that word passion shows up in your Bible, right here. And it's not talking about being on fire for Jesus. This word passion is used in the sense of suffering. Right, his passion was the suffering he went through, okay? And so that's the only time it shows up here. Very different than the way people use it in church nowadays, but if you talk about the need to suffer for the Lord in church, you wouldn't have so many people excited, I think, for the Lord as they say they're trying to promote. But anyway, moving on. He says he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs. Now, this is the only time that word infallible shows up in your Bible, right there in that verse, and it's concerning the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. The proof is resurrection. It says infallible, cannot be denied. These are certain proofs. These aren't questionable. These aren't doubtful. These aren't just proofs, which, by the way, is how it's displayed in the ESV and in ASV. It's just proofs. Okay, there's not infallible proofs. It's just proofs. But here in the King James, you have infallible proofs. Okay, cannot be denied. All right. Taking words out of your Bible matters, I think. And I think it reflects the attitude people have towards the Bible. Take out that word infallible because men can't be infallible, right? Well, this is God's word, you see, and he showed himself alive to these men. I mean, that is infallible. Revelation is infallible. When God speaks, it is true, no question, right? So I think it reflects people's attitude a bit, that they ignore that so many words are changed or removed from the Bible, but that's my little rabbit trail. Let's get back to the verse. To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days. The length of time there that he showed himself. It wasn't a one-time sighting, okay? The Marys saw him multiple times, right? Remember the first time that Jesus showed himself to the Marys there at the tomb, the disciples didn't believe him. Remember that? Back in John 20 and 21, in Mark 16, you read the account where they see the Lord, like, whoa, he's alive. And they go back and they tell the disciples, and they don't believe them. Silly women. You know, they don't believe them, right? The first time, was it Mary Magdalene that saw the empty tomb before she saw the Lord resurrected? She saw the tomb and said, someone stole the body. And then she went back and told Peter and John and said, guys, someone stole the body. And they go to the tomb and they agree with her that someone stole the body. They did not believe the resurrection before they saw the Lord resurrected. Infallible proofs? Yeah. That's what happened in Luke 24 when Jesus appeared to them and they're all jaws dropped. You're dead. What are you doing here? And then he said, well, give me some of that cereal. You know, he ate some honeycomb there. And he said, he starts eating it. And they say, he's alive. Right? And so infallible proofs in Luke 24 are given. And that's what Luke's referring to in Acts chapter 1, verse 3. For 40 days he gave this. Now, the 40 days that he appeared to these apostles gives us the time frame that the book of Acts here is starting to talk about. There are 40 days after his resurrection, and there are 50 days after his resurrection to the day of Pentecost. That's what Pentecost means, 50. And the Pentecost day is celebrated 50 days after the Feast of First Fruits. Right? And so the first fruits feast was a picture and a type of Christ's resurrection. That was fulfilled. The Passover was a picture and type of Christ's death. That was fulfilled. The Feast of Unleavened Bread has to do with bread not rising. That was Jesus in the grave for 3 days. And so we've talked about the calendar before and how the Jewish calendar happened during the week of Jesus' passion, where he died on Passover and he was buried on the day of Unleavened Bread. And then on the day of the first fruits, he rose from the dead. And then 50 days after that is the day of Pentecost, which you see in Acts chapter 2. Those holy days given to Israel were prophecies of what would happen when Jesus came. Okay, the other remaining holidays have not yet been fulfilled. The Day of Atonement, the Tabernacles, the Trumpets, these all refer to the Lord's second coming when he dwells with Israel. Right. Anyway, another topic for another day. Here we see the 40 days in that time frame between the first fruits and the Pentecost. And what is he speaking to them for 40 days? He's not just showing himself and disappearing. He's there talking with them, teaching them, speaking to them of things concerning the kingdom of God, pertaining to the kingdom of God. Okay, that's significant as well. Most people really blur the line between the gospel of the kingdom and the gospel of the grace of God, which we've talked about before. Okay, the gospel of the kingdom in Mark 1:14 is clearly defined as the preaching that the kingdom is at hand. The kingdom that was promised to David in 2 Samuel 7, that forever there'd be a king and a kingdom in his line, right? The kingdom promised to Israel was far back as Genesis 12 and 15. The kingdom was at hand is the gospel that Jesus preached. That's the gospel John the Baptist preached. That's the gospel that the 12 apostles preached. And they preached that not knowing at all, okay, that Jesus Christ needed to die. And you can prove that, of course, going to Luke chapter 9. In Luke chapter 18, in Luke chapter 9, Jesus sends these apostles that he chose to preach the gospel. And then in Luke 18, 9 chapters later, he tells them for the first time, I'm going to die. And his disciples say, we don't know what you're talking about. If they didn't know what he was talking about, the gospel they were preaching before did not include the preaching of the cross, which is our gospel. The gospel of the grace of God is that you're a sinner, that you need Christ's salvation and his provision through the cross to save you. So there is a difference there. So when Jesus spends 40 days preaching the kingdom of God or speaking the kingdom of God to these apostles, he's educating them about the prophets. Let's look back at Luke 24. Look at Luke 24. Verse Notice he's speaking to the apostles here about these things. He's not going around town preaching. This is going to be the responsibility of the apostles after they receive the power of the Holy Spirit. But Jesus is speaking to these apostles. Now, you would think after 3.5 years of ministry with these guys, they would have had a clue about, you know, what it is they were supposed to be doing. And they did. They wrote the Gospels, you know, by the inspiration of the Spirit. But there were things that were changing here. I mean, why did Jesus die? He's resurrected. Why is he going away? You know, is the kingdom coming? Now, there's questions that they have. And Jesus is speaking to them about these things. In Luke 24:45, notice here, this is a verse that a lot of people use to try to say, well, this is where the disciples learned about the gospel, the grace of God. And this is where Jesus opened their eyes to this mystery information that the church now preaches. Okay? In Luke 24:45, Jesus here appears after his resurrection to the apostles, and it says, He opened their understanding, that they might understand the scriptures. And he said to them, thus it is written, and thus it behoved Christ to suffer, that's his passion, and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Okay, so we have here the opening of their understanding. And the question is, what did they now understand? Of course, the next verse says clearly they understood that it behoved Christ to suffer. That means what he was going through in Matthew, Luke, and John, the suffering there and his crucifixion, the prophets spoke about that. And when it talks about the resurrection from the dead after the third day, the prophets spoke about that. And this is exactly true. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15 that his death was according to the Scriptures. His resurrection was according to the Scriptures, right? That's what he says there. But nowhere in here do you see the preaching of the cross for salvation without Israel, without the law, without the covenants. You don't see that anywhere here. You see Jesus explain to these disciples from the Scriptures how that he needed to die, he needed to resurrect. These things must needs have been, right? Go back up to verse 44. Okay, what did he open their eyes to understand? Verse 44, he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Right? And then he opens their eyes to understand it. So he's opening their eyes to the law and the prophets and the Psalms. Right? To the scripture that had been written since the world began. In Romans 16:25, Paul preaches, and we know this verse because we say it so many times, he preaches Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. And so contrary to what Peter preaches in Acts 3 and what Jesus is opening their eyes to in Luke 24, Paul preaches something that was not spoken of by the prophets. Okay, look at Ephesians chapter 3. I need to spend some time on this just because we're in Acts chapter 1 and 2 here. This is where people say the birthday of the church is, and this is the fundamental issue in Acts 1 and 2. Is what they're doing there a new thing that was a mystery kept secret? Is it without Israel, without the covenants, without the law, concerning the church that we're a part of now? Or was it something that was a fulfillment of prophecy since the world began, a continuation of God's purpose with Israel for the earth? That's the question, okay? Ephesians chapter 3 in verse 1 and 2, Paul says, I'm the prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles. If ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which has given me to you word, how that by revelation God made known unto me the mystery. And then he says down in verse 5, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men. You see that? Did God make known the mystery to the sons of men before? No. The verse says, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. And so the revelation of the mystery is by the Spirit now. It was not before the Spirit was given to prophets, Psalms, and Moses back into law. Okay? You know what it says there? Verse 5 or verse 6 then explains what that mystery is. Look at Colossians chapter 1. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 26. Paul says, I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God given to me for you, to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages. Ages would be time. It was hid from all time. And from generations, that would be people, right? Family generations. But now was made manifest to his saints. And then it goes on to explain what that is. So Paul, in all of his epistles, makes known this secret, this mystery of what Christ is doing now. Okay, in Luke 24:44, Jesus is explaining, opening their eyes to what was already written. In John 6, doesn't he say, John 5, excuse me, he says, search the scriptures, they speak of me, right? He says, search them. Paul says in Ephesians 3, we preach Jesus, the unsearchable riches of Christ. There are things you could search in the law, Psalms, and prophets and know about Jesus. And there are things you cannot search in there. The things you cannot search in the law, Psalms, and the prophets have been revealed according to the mystery to Paul. There is a difference. But of course, there are things in the prophets that speak of Christ's death. Foremost is Isaiah 53. Are you familiar with Isaiah 53? There's a wonderful video on the internet where you have an evangelist going over and talking to some Jews who are not Christians, and he explains how there's a chapter that isn't read very much in Jewish synagogues today. That's Isaiah 53. Because when you read Isaiah 53, it sounds very much like Jesus Christ. And in fact, it's a prophecy of Jesus Christ, talking about him suffering for innocently for the wrongdoing of his people, and people accusing him of crimes, and how, you know, God put him there and he took upon him the iniquities of the nation and things like that. That's Isaiah 53. So no doubt Jesus is saying, look guys, didn't you read this chapter? Haven't you read Psalm 2? Haven't you read Psalm 110? Don't you know that the Messiah had to die? Don't you know that he had to suffer first and then the glory happens? Right? Prophecy speaks about that. But what's the glory? The glory is their kingdom. The glory is him being the king, right? The glory is not the mystery glory according to the church, where we have all these things freely. The glory was what God was purposing through Israel. There are still 12 apostles in Luke 24 because they're going to sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. God's working to bless the earth as he promised Abraham through their nation, right? The difference between that and how God's working today is that God is now offering salvation to the world without Israel. It's through a church, a body made of Jew and Gentile. Well, there's neither Jew nor Gentile. We're going to all men. There's no nationality. There's no nation we're to control. It's simply the church preaching salvation to all freely based on the cross of Jesus Christ, right? Very different than the purpose that he had to Israel and through Israel, okay? So Luke 24, 45, he opened their understanding, and yet we see that what they understood was not the mystery. That would explain why later in the book of Acts, Paul has to go to Jerusalem and explain to Peter, you can be saved without circumcision, right? If they understood the mystery in Luke 24, why are they debating that issue? Why are they in the temple in Acts 2? Why is the last verse in Luke 24, what does it say in Luke 24, 53? They were continually in the temple, praising and blessing God. Why? Why were they in a Jewish temple? The Jewish temple in Jerusalem. Why? Because they were not told anything about, you know, not being under that Israel new covenant, not being under the law, not being a nation. They're told about the kingdom. In Acts chapter 1, they were taught about the kingdom of God. Okay, the kingdom that they were preaching, the kingdom that would come. Peter writes in his epistle, in 1 Peter, in the first few verses, he says, we have a renewed hope, a lively hope, now that Christ is raised from the dead. The disciples were walking around mourning that Christ had died. So when he rose from the dead, and Acts 1 says he showed himself to them by many infallible proofs, they have a renewed hope now that they can preach the kingdom because they have a king that's risen from the dead. If their king was dead, it's going to be hard preaching the kingdom, right? So they're hopeless at that point. Christ raises from the dead, infallible proofs happen, and now they have a renewed hope, a hope of a kingdom, okay? So that's what we're at in Acts 1, verse 3. And we need to realize that these guys were intelligent. They understood these things. It says in Luke 24, Christ opened their eyes to understand them. They were not ignorant. It's going to be important two verses later. Okay, and we'll see why here in a moment. Okay, let's look at verse 4, Acts 1, verse 4, where it says, being assembled together, and this is one long sentence Luke's writing here, talking about Christ showing himself to these men, and he being assembled together with them. It wasn't just a distant sighting. He was among them. He commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. You want to follow the commandments of the Lord? You can't follow that one. You buy a plane ticket, go over there, don't depart, but you're not going to do that one, right? So I remember one guy telling me at the fair, I do everything God says to do in the Bible. And I think I know his intent. He wanted to do that, but I tried to explain to him gently, explaining to the Bible, you can't do everything God said in the Bible. Because there's things in the Bible that weren't spoken to you. There's things in the Bible that are for different people at a different time. You can't do everything. The Jews today can't do everything that God told them to do. And they don't even believe the Christian Bible. They're trying to follow the law, but they can't do that either. I've told you many times before how that Jews today don't tithe. You know, and Christians preach tithing, but Jews don't. That seems kind of weird. And the tithing law was given to Jews. Well, why don't they tithe? Because they know the law better than Christians. The law says you can only tithe when there's a temple. You can only tithe to the Levitical priesthood. No temple, no priesthood, no tithe. So they don't tithe. Now, they give gift to charity and that sort of thing, but they don't tithe according to the law. They can't, just the same way they don't sacrifice animals. They would if they could, but they can't. In Acts 1, in verse 4 here, they assembled, and Jesus commands them not to depart from Jerusalem. Why, is our question, is what you should be asking. Why? Is this what the church is supposed to be doing here? Is this the pattern for the church? Let's go to Jerusalem and start there. Let's make sure the Jews get saved first before anyone else. Is this what we're supposed to do? You know, we should love men, love our neighbor, and Jews can be saved. They're not condemned from God to not have salvation. But is that the church's mission? Well, surely we would say not so, right? But people say we find our pattern here in Acts 1 and 2. And Jesus said, don't depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father. You say, nobody thinks they have to go to Jerusalem and just stay there. Well, I understand that, but in the same verse, people think they have to sit around and wait for the promise of the Holy Spirit all the time. They have tarrying meetings, and they pray for the Holy Spirit to come down, like at Pentecost, and it's the same in the same passage, in the same context, right? So what authority do they have to say, well, I'm not going to go to Jerusalem, but I am going to wait for the promise of the Father? Why? And of course, the reality is that pastors and preachers, when they try to get people excited about something and God moving in their life, they don't care about the context. They proof text. That Jerusalem part, we're going to wait for the promise of the Father. So you need to come here and gather together, and we need to assemble, as the verse says, and we need to wait for the promise of the Father. And we need to pray, as Jesus said in John. He said, he'll pray the Holy Spirit come down. So let's pray the Holy Spirit come down. You know, and they take verses that meet their agenda instead of, as we're trying to do here, go in the context verse by verse. Okay. So Jesus says, go to Jerusalem, don't depart, wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. What is this promise of the Father? And why are they not departing from Jerusalem? We're going to see here in a moment that the reason why that they're supposed to stay in Jerusalem is to fulfill prophecy. That's why. It wasn't just because it was their closest town, and later in the commission that Jesus gave, and people distort that and they say, well, your Jerusalem is, I don't know, Swayze? That's our Jerusalem, I guess. You know, is it your hometown, right? That's not why Jesus said that. Okay? He said that because Jerusalem had a special significance in God's purpose for the earth. It was the capital city, the temple city of his chosen nation, and it was to fulfill prophecy. That's why in Acts chapter 8, verse 1, when Saul was persecuting these guys, most of the group there, most of the believers in Jerusalem left, except for who? Guess. The guys Jesus said, don't leave Jerusalem. Right? Because they knew why. They knew why. It wasn't just, oh, Jesus said to stay here. They were being taught of him for 40 days. They understood the kingdom and how that would work and how they were being given a position that the priests and the rulers in Israel were rejecting. Okay? Peter had more authority and was giving keys to Israel's kingdom. Shouldn't those keys have been given to, I don't know, a high priest instead of a fisherman? Yeah, they should have been, but they weren't. Peter had faith, right? And he gave them to Peter, gave them to the 12. And so those guys had a position. They needed to stay in Jerusalem. To fulfill prophecy, Jerusalem had to be saved. And then not just Jerusalem, but Judea. Those are the southern tribes that were faithful to the Lord. And then not just Judea, but Samaria, those 10 tribes. So all 12 tribes of Israel needed to be on board with Jesus being the Messiah. And then all 12 tribes as a unit of priests and ministers of the Lord, according to Isaiah 60, could go to the uttermost part of the world and preach Christ and the kingdom. Right? That's what prophecy said would happen. Salvation to the world through Israel. Okay, beginning at Jerusalem. So in Acts 8:1, the disciples here, it says that all those that believed in Jerusalem, the church which was at Jerusalem, they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles in Acts 8:1. Because in Acts 1, Jesus said, stay there, don't depart. Okay, wait for the promise of the Father. Now, what's this promise? Well, let's turn back to John 7. Luke's the only one that explains this, by the way. Matthew and Mark, again, and John, just because they have a different purpose in their writing of those books, they don't explain anything about the disciples waiting in Jerusalem. Okay, Matthew, in his commission in Matthew 28, is very legalistic. He explains that you got to follow those laws, those commandments that Jesus told them to do. Mark 16, in his commission, he talks about those gifts and those signs that will follow you if you believe. But both of them end with, go and preach, you know. And so you may think, oh, okay, well, go and preach. That's the message. John ends with, well, now you know he's the Son of God, you know, because I've just proven it to you. Luke ends with this commission of, you're going to be endued with power from the Holy Spirit. You need to stay in Jerusalem and wait for that. And Acts 1 says, before you preach, you need to wait in Jerusalem to wait for this Holy Spirit. Okay, stay there. You're in John chapter 7. Jesus promised, and part of his ministry was promising this Holy Spirit. This is part of prophecy. People will tell you, as we get on through the book of Acts, you'll see, we'll talk about this, that people will say the church began in Acts chapter 2. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is there. Is the Holy Spirit is what baptizes you into Christ in 1 Corinthians 12, and the Holy Spirit is the beginning of the church, right? And we'll see it this week and a little bit next week as well, that the Holy Spirit was part of prophecy, folks. The Spirit and His coming down from heaven was part of prophecy. And if it was part of prophecy, what can it not be? Part of the mystery, right? The mystery was kept secret. Prophecy was spoken already. See, it's really that simple when you to rightly divide. It's what was prophesied and what was kept secret. Right? That's how you rightly divide. And the Spirit coming down, Jesus already spoke about. And not just Jesus, it was spoken about in Proverbs. Proverbs 1:23. Solomon says he'll pour out his Spirit. Right? Isaiah says multiple times he'll pour out his Spirit on Israel. Okay? I'm getting ahead of myself here. Let's look at John chapter 7, verse 38. John 7, verse 38. Verse 37, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believes on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Notice what Jesus said. As the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. What's he talking about? Verse 39, it gives you what he's talking about, so it's very easy here to study this passage. This spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. That's what we're talking about in Acts 1. Jesus says, well, wait here until you get the Spirit. Okay, wait in Jerusalem. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given because that Jesus was not yet glorified. How useful that John puts that here in a parenthesis as he speaks about the past and says, Jesus said this in his ministry, and he was expounding the scriptures, the prophecies, and he was speaking of the Spirit. We know this now because he told us to wait for the Spirit and explain to us about this, the Spirit and the kingdom. Right? That's what John's saying here. The Holy Ghost was not yet given. Why wasn't the Holy Ghost given yet, John? Because Jesus was not yet glorified. So he understood something about the prophecies, how that the Messiah had to suffer and then be glorified, and then the Spirit would come down. That's what the prophets said would happen. Right? It's exactly what they said would happen. And Jesus spoke of it. So in Acts 1, when he says, wait for the promise of the Father, which I have spoken to you. You've heard of me before already. Okay. Why does he call it the promise of the Father? Okay. Why does he call it that? Well, look at John chapter, you know, not John. Let's look at Matthew chapter 3, verse 11. Matthew 3:11. Who sent John the Baptist to preach? Did Jesus send Matthew to preach, or John the Baptist to preach? It was God the Father. Okay, in John chapter 1, John says, the Father sent me. God sent me to identify the Messiah. In Matthew 3, verse 11, we have in this verse a very fascinating thing. You need to start this one. To talk to your Baptist friends about there being more than one baptism in the Bible. Okay, in fact, there's a dozen at least baptisms in the Bible, because baptism is simply the process in which you're identified with something. You're a freshman on the football team. They throw you out there in scrimmage against the seniors, you know, and you get trampled upon. Well, you've been baptized. You are now part of the team. You know, you're identified with something. Your first week at work, you're identified now as a worker because you've been baptized by fire, as they say, which is something they take from the Bible, you know. But that is, you've gone through some suffering, some tribulation with this group, and so now you're part of the team, right? You're identified with them. That's what baptism is. It's identification. And the Baptists would like to tell you it means immersed. But it's more than that. It's not just being dunked. It's identified with something. And so the idea of the immersion is simply you being so involved with it or identified with it. You're like immersed in it. As if, as the scholars like to explain, a sock being immersed in dye. It's not the immersion part, it's that when you pull the sock back out, it's now the color of the dye. It's identified with the color, you know. And so that's the idea of baptism. In Matthew 3, verse 11, John the Baptist says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. Why would he be baptizing with water unto repentance? A couple reasons. Number one, the law spoke about that. The law baptized people with water to clean themselves from sin. And so when John the Baptist comes preaching against sin and repentance of sin, he comes baptizing with water. When the Pharisees came to John the Baptist, they did not ask him, what in the world are you doing? And he said, I'm creating a new ordinance for the church. They said, why are you baptizing? In John 1. And he explained, well, I'm doing it for repentance. I'm identifying the Messiah. That's what they asked him. So I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that comes after me, this is Jesus, he's mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. And so what is this? You're baptized with water, you're identified with water being a cleaning agent, and thus baptized unto repentance, you know, being clean. Baptized with the Holy Ghost, what does this mean? Well, you're going to be identified with that Holy Ghost, aren't you not? You're going to be identified with the power of the Spirit, which we'll see here in a moment. Now, there's a third baptism in this verse. It says he'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And that fire in the tongues of fire that we see in Acts 2 is what people think that is. It really is not that at all. This is another baptism. Isaiah 4 talks about that one. This is a baptism with fire, which speaks about God bringing judgment on the world. So Christ will come to bring judgment on the world. That's his baptism of fire. But meanwhile, we'll deal with that in Acts 2. Okay? Let's see it again in, where do I want to go with this? John chapter 14. John 14. Jesus spoke of this Spirit coming. This was not a surprise in Acts 2. If it wasn't a surprise in Acts 2, then it wasn't a mystery. It was something they could know about. It was something the law, Psalms, and the prophets spoke about. It was something Jesus opened their understanding to know. In John 14 and verse 26, these things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to remembrance whatsoever I said unto you. So lest you think that when I leave, and I've been telling you I'm leaving, and I know you guys don't understand that, and you don't like that I talk about this all the time. You know, Mark 9 is a funny verse in Mark 9:32, where Jesus tells his disciples, I'm going to be crucified. I'm going to die. And it's just the next verse, and you know they didn't understand this, but they were afraid to ask him. They were afraid to ask him. Like, Jesus talked about this to his disciples in private so often that they were like, we don't know why he's talking about that, and we're kind of afraid to ask him about why he's talking about death and dying. Well, we're out preaching kingdom, you know. But they were afraid to ask him about it. In John 14, he says, I speak these things being with you, but, you know, don't be afraid. The Comforter is going to come to comfort you, and he'll bring to remembrance what I've said unto you. Right? So it's not that you've got to scribble all these things down. The Holy Spirit's going to remind you of them, and he's the one, of course, that inspired these books here, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Right? And so this Comforter, this Holy Ghost, has a function, a ministry, a purpose. He's a person with a ministry that he's going to perform with these apostles. And so when Jesus says, wait for the promise of the Father, wait for the Holy Ghost, the disciples know exactly what he's talking about. Okay? And he was identified in John 14 as the Father sending the Holy Ghost. Look at John chapter 15, verse 26. John 15, 26. When the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, so again, there's the promise of the Spirit from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceeds from the Father, he, the Spirit of truth, the Holy Ghost, shall testify of me. So this tells you what the Holy Spirit is speaking, is what he's going to say. People talk about the Spirit telling them things and the Spirit speaking to them, and as we've been studying on Sunday mornings, the Spirit speaks to you through God's Word, right? But more than that, we can know what the Spirit talks about. The Spirit talks about Christ. That's what the Spirit talks about. It says in John 15, he will testify of me, which means if Christ is to be preached according to prophecy, the Spirit will testify of Christ according to prophecy. If Christ is to be testified based on what they saw and handled, then the Spirit will testify Christ based on what people can see and handle. Healing, miracles, right? But if Christ is to be preached according to the mystery of what people cannot see and had not seen and walking by faith instead of sight, the Spirit will testify of Christ according to the mystery, not based on what they see, not based on sight and what they can touch. Okay? This means today in the church, you cannot identify someone as having the Holy Ghost Is this true or false? There's some churches who will disagree with me when I say that. They would say, well, you only know you have the Holy Ghost if you're evidenced with speaking in tongues. That's biblical. Not for this dispensation. Right? Wrong dispensation. Yes, there was a time when the Holy Ghost was poured on people, and the only way you can identify them as being baptized with the Holy Ghost is if the Holy Ghost manifested himself to you. Right? But that's not the ministry of the Holy Ghost now, who testifies of Christ according to the mystery. Today we look at people and we do not know if the Spirit dwells in them or not. How you can know if the Spirit dwells in you is because the Bible says so. Ephesians 1:13 says that you believe the gospel of your salvation, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. You believe it by faith. It says it, he's in me, right? And I'm the temple of the Holy Ghost in 1 Corinthians 3:16. That's how we know. But John 15:26, Jesus promised the Spirit would come and testify of him and remind them of things. In John 16:7, we see it again. I go to all these verses to show you that the Spirit and his coming in Acts 2 was not something that was secret. In John 16:7, nevertheless, I tell you truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. It's a good thing that I leave, Jesus says. Why? For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you, but if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin, and it says of righteousness and of judgment. And so there's things that he has to say, and I can't say them to you now, but the Holy Spirit's going to say them to you. Right? So there's a reason why Jesus has to leave. We'll talk about this next week. Why Jesus had to go to heaven. You ever think about this? And we've got to take it for granted that Jesus isn't here on earth. I mean, he ascended to heaven. We all know the story. But why? I mean, he was made flesh. He was here. He died. He rose from the dead. It's not like he had to leave, right? Why didn't he just stay around? Why did he leave? This is a good question. And the answer is to fulfill prophecy. There was an order of events that had to happen, and his ascension was part of that. The Spirit being poured out was part of that. John 16 says this, okay? If you look at in Acts chapter 2, the next chapter, we'll cover in a few weeks here. Acts 2 verse 33, when Peter is preaching here, being filled with the Holy Spirit, he says that this Jesus, this is the Spirit testifying of Jesus, this Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we all are witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth this, which ye now see and hear, our speaking in tongues and our preaching. Right? We're testifying of the Lord Jesus Christ. So you see it right there, the promise of the Holy Ghost that the Father sent as the Lord went to heaven, and he would not have been sent if the Lord did not go to heaven. Okay? Hebrews 10:13, we'll deal with this next week. Hebrews 10:13 talks about the Lord taking his blood up to the heavenly tabernacle and offering it to the Lord. And after he was done offering it, he sat down because it was finished once for all. Okay? He gave this blood, and the Father sends the Spirit. The Lord sits down. The Spirit comes up. There's no way the Spirit's coming back unless the Lord goes up to the heavenly tabernacle. Unless the Lord goes up to heaven and does what he needs to perform up there, the Spirit's not coming down. Okay? And of course, that has to happen to fulfill prophecy, and we now know that has to happen for the church to be created eventually, right? So all these things are put in place according to prophecy. Look at John 20. We'll see one more verse in John here just to get us equipped for this Acts 1 verse 8. In John 20 verse 21, there's a commission from the Lord in each of the four Gospels and in the first chapter of the book of Acts. Okay, Jeremy did a great lesson earlier this year about the commissions. And John 20 is the least talked about among Protestants, the most talked about among Roman Catholics. Okay, John 20, God gives a commission. Christ gives a commission to his disciples, and it has to do with their being able to forgive sins. And if you're a Roman Catholic, you're loving that because that's what they teach. They teach apostolic authority down from Peter, keys of the kingdom, power to bind and loose, and priests in Roman Catholicism can forgive your sins, right? As priests of the Lord getting authority from the Pope down through Peter, right? So in John 20, verse 21, here's Jesus, and he's showing himself to them by the infallible proofs once again. And he says in verse 20, when he had said so, he showed them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and saith unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. Whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. Wow. There's no way around that verse, folks. If you think John 3:16, Matthew, Luke, and John is for you, what do you say to that? Because that gives authority to these guys to forgive sins. Now, a lot of people, a lot of Protestants, will excuse this passage and say really what it's saying is giving authority to the apostles to preach the gospel of forgiveness of sins. But that's not what the verse says. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retained, they are retained. Can't be any more clear than that. Ricky Kurth at the Brigham Bible Society wrote an article about this recently. He said the same thing. He said he's given authority to preach the gospel to forgive sins. And that's simply not what it's saying. C.R. Stan wrote in his book, it's saying clearly you can forgive sins, right? And that's because these apostles were given authority from the Lord Jesus Christ to do that. Not everybody that followed Jesus, these apostles were, that's why I told you earlier, these commissions were given to the apostles. The apostles were given that authority. They were given positions to judge the 12 tribes of Israel. What were they to judge? Sins, right? They were given the authority to remit them or retain them. Peter was given keys to bind and loose. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. What does that mean? It has to do with their authority to bind and loose in the kingdom. Who gets in, who gets out? You say, well, how could God trust any man to do that? Because we're fallible. You know, we're not perfect. And wouldn't there be corruption? Why would he commit that to these men? Because look what he did before he said that. Receive ye the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost would fill these men and give them powers that, quite frankly, we do not have today. The Holy Ghost gave these men powers to know things and to speak things. In Luke 12:12, Jesus says, don't be afraid, the Spirit will tell you what words to speak and will bring you into remembrance, and he'll give you knowledge of things that you do not have. Okay? I can testify that that's not how the Spirit works in my life. And maybe by my confession of that, you think I'm an unsaved person. But I believe my whole heart that I'm saved based on the cross of Christ. But that's not how the Spirit works in my life. He's not giving me supernatural knowledge of all your secret sins. I don't know, right? There's a difference. Okay, these guys were given the Holy Ghost, and don't we see that in Acts 4? We'll get there eventually. Where Ananias and Sapphira had a secret sin. Peter had no way of knowing about it, and the Holy Ghost gave him the knowledge of it, and he retained their sins, didn't he? He retained their sins, and they dropped dead, and they dragged him out. Right? We saw that it practiced there. We also see the forgiveness of sins being practiced as well by Peter and the apostles. Only with the filling of the Holy Ghost as it related to the kingdom. When the kingdom is not being preached anymore and the Holy Ghost ministry changes from that of giving these powers to that of preaching Christ crucified, you dare not give men who, as we talked about on Sunday in Romans 7, still have sin in them the power to retain and remit sins. You're going to have trouble. Right? And that's exactly what's happened in the Catholic Church. They give the power to men, fallible men, probably unsaved men, right, to remit sins, and it becomes a political battle, a spiritual political battle. And within men's souls, they keep them from salvation, not knowing that forgiveness is through the blood of Christ alone, you know, not through the power. Why didn't Jesus tell these guys, just preach my blood for the forgiveness of sins? Preach that all your sins are forgiven, and you go preach reconciliation to the world. I've reconciled the whole world to myself. Go preach this. Why didn't he say that? He told Paul that, right? And that's because what I just explained to you is the revelation of the mystery, kept secret. This is not the mystery. There's no preaching of the cross right there. Okay? This is a power in a kingdom, authority in a kingdom. So, well, let's keep going here. Luke chapter 1. We're seeing a context here laid out where Jesus, as he's commanding and giving these commandments in person to the apostles in Acts 1, and giving them this commission. He's giving them this commission to continue preaching this kingdom, and he's telling them that you're going to have the power to do so. You know, this Holy Spirit's going to give you the power to do that. Luke 1, verse 15. We'll see in a bit when John the Baptist said that he that comes after me will baptize you with the Holy Ghost. It's to identify them with the Holy Ghost and his power. And we see precedent for this in the Bible. We see evidence of this in the Bible in other people. Okay, what was going to be different in Acts 2 is when the Spirit fills all of them. That's the difference. But the Spirit filled people before in the Bible, and we see it all throughout the Bible. What we don't see is the Spirit filling everybody that believes. We don't see that. But in Luke 1:15, we see here, talking about John the Baptist. It says, he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost from his mother's womb. That's interesting. So the Holy Ghost will fill him from his mother's womb. John the Baptist. Did everybody that was baptized of John get the Holy Ghost? No. He said, I can't baptize you with the Holy Ghost. Only God can. Only Christ can. Right? Look at Luke chapter 1 and verse 41. John the Baptist was empowered by the Holy Ghost. You got to eat that. What was he eating? Locusts? Whew. Luke 1:41. Where's a Big Mac? It came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. And she spake with a loud voice, prophesying, blessed art thou among women. What happens when Elizabeth gets filled with the Holy Ghost right here? She speaks prophecy. She speaks something from the Lord that she didn't invent. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed art is the fruit of thy womb, and whence is this to me? And Roman Catholics take that, and they go, wow, that's a prayer, right? That's a Hail Mary. That's what that is, right? But the point I'm trying to point out here is when someone's filled with the Holy Ghost, it's followed with God speaking. It's identified, you can identify God in them by what they say, by what they're doing. Okay? And it's quite evident. Look at Luke chapter 1, verse 67. See it again here with Zacharias. Zacharias, John the Baptist's daddy. He was mute because of the angel that silenced his mouth of unbelief. But after John the Baptist was born, his father, Zacharias, was filled with the Holy Ghost. And what happened after he was filled with the Holy Ghost? He prophesied. And he goes on prophesying for some 15 verses or so about what God's going to do through John the Baptist and Jesus and everything else. So what happens in the Bible when someone's filled with the Holy Spirit? They prophesy. They speak in tongues. They have power. Elijah, filled with the Holy Ghost, what did he do? Miracles. In 1 Samuel 10, Saul, the first king of Israel, Samuel goes up to Saul and says, you're going to be the king of Israel, and you're going to be filled with the Holy Spirit. So he says, when we walk over there to these guys, when you go over there, the Spirit will fill you. And he does that. 1 Samuel 10:10, Saul walks over there and the Spirit fills him. The first thing he does is prophesies. Right? He can't control that. It happens. God worked through him to do that. So, again, there's precedent in the Bible for this. So in Acts 2, when we see the Spirit coming here, what do you think is going to happen? They already know. It's already been spoken of. Jesus says, wait for the promise of the Father, the Spirit, which saith he, you've heard of me, and John the Baptist spoke about, because you're going to get that, which you've seen in some people, but you're all going to get it. Wow. Great. Wow. Wonderful. You know, we're going to prophesy. We're going to have this power, okay, which is exactly what it was. It was the power of the Holy Ghost. In fact, in Luke 24, you got your hand back in that chapter. You'll see Luke 24 and Acts 1 have a lot of cross references. The commissions are very similar. In Luke 24, verse 47, Jesus says to preach repentance and remission of sins, which you've already seen in John 20, could come from the power of these apostles, and that it should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Do you see that? So in Acts 1, he says, you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost. In Luke 24, he says, you're going to be endued with power. What's it mean to be baptized with the Holy Ghost? Endued with power, right? Are you baptized with the Holy Ghost? That's a good question. We're baptized by the Holy Ghost, not with him, because our identification is not with the Holy Ghost and the power that he possesses. Our identification is with what? With Christ. We're identified with Christ. And so we're baptized by the Spirit into Christ's body. Romans 6 says we're baptized into Christ's death and into Christ's resurrection. We're baptized into Christ. And so what are we identified by? How do you identify a saved person today? If they testify you, the cross of Christ. I'm crucified with Christ. Christ died for me. He rose from the dead, right? That's how you identify a saved person. Not by some power of the Holy Ghost. We are not baptized with the Holy Ghost. We're baptized by him into Christ. Okay, so a big difference here, and we'll see that's what Jesus is saying. Wait for the promise of the Father, that thing which the prophets have spoken about, what I told you about, what John the Baptist told you about, that you'll get power from on high. Okay, that's what he's saying. So he tells them this, and he's getting ready to take off. He's got his cape and everything. In Acts 1, verse 6, when they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time, restore again the kingdom to Israel? This is an amazing verse right here. This verse will help you deal with the amillennialists and the postmillennialists and the premillennialists who think the church began in Acts 2. Okay? This verse right here, Acts 1, verse 6. Because we've already established how the apostles had their eyes open to understand the scriptures. Jesus taught them for 40 days. We've already established how they understood the baptism with the Holy Ghost and what that meant and how Christ had to suffer and how he had to die and he had to resurrect and he had to leave them and go to heaven. And they understood these prophetic events. They understood what was good to come in the kingdom. They've been preaching the kingdom since the beginning of Jesus' ministry in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They understood all these things. And commentators will tell you that the apostles had no clue that the kingdom was not literal. In the kingdom, they just didn't understand that the kingdom was not supposed to be a literal kingdom on earth in Israel. It was supposed to be a spiritual kingdom called the church. And they'll tell you, the amillennials tell you that because they don't believe in a kingdom at all. They believe in just the spiritual working of God and people. The premillennialists who think the church began here, they think that the church today is Israel in some regard. And so when he's talking about the kingdom and the church are the same thing. They got to make that the same thing because these apostles are preaching the kingdom. And they say they're preaching the church, and so they got to be the same thing. And so when they ask, will you restore again the kingdom to Israel? There's no way around this question. Okay, number one is they're asking this question after knowing what Jesus has already told them and taught them. And secondly, they're very specific with the question. It's not just to restore the kingdom, but to restore again the kingdom. When was the kingdom given to Israel before? David, Solomon, right? When Israel was a nation at that time above the other nations. Okay, and all the nations came to Solomon and gave him riches and that sort of thing. So he says, restore again. Will you restore again the kingdom? Israel knew, and we know from the Bible, that that kingdom in Israel had been destroyed. The Assyrians came and destroyed the city. They had to rebuild the temple, but even when they rebuilt the temple, it was under authority of the Gentiles, right? So the kingdom had never, since the time of David and Solomon, been under authority. Since the time of those kings there in Israel, been under the authority of Israel, of God. So will you restore again the kingdom? But then the last two words there make it even more specific. Again, to Israel. If the kingdom concerns the church, neither Jew nor Gentile, the whole world of saved believers, then why does he say to Israel? Why is he asking that? Are they dumb? You know, Christ just got done talking to them about the kingdom for 40 days. Don't they understand the kingdom is actually within you and it's spiritual and it's the church? They don't understand any of that. It's a mystery. It's not part of Acts 1 verse 6. Their question and what their knowledge is about is the kingdom. And again, we have to go back to the verse here. They're not asking, are you going to restore again the kingdom to Israel? That's not the question. The question is, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? There was no question that God was going to restore again the kingdom to Israel. Which is funny, because that is the question among theologians today, is whether Israel has a future kingdom or not. Right? Will Israel return? Will there be a kingdom? Are the prophecies literal? And they debate back and forth. The covenant theologians say no. Right? The amillennialists say no. The postmillennialists say no. Okay, the premillennialists say yes, but they still put the church here in Acts 1, in Acts 2. Okay. But they're asking, when are you going to at this time? This is a dispensational question. This is a timing question. You know, just like when Jesus was offered the kingdoms of the world by the devil and he turned them down, right? Because it wasn't time, right? And then there was a time in Jesus' ministry where he says, it's time for me to go to the cross. There's a time to God's purpose and things. And so when Jesus explained it in the kingdom, their question was on the timing. Are you going to do that now? Right? And Jesus says in verse 7, no, guys, no, silly. No, he doesn't say that. He doesn't say no. He doesn't say yes. Right? What's he saying in verse 7? It is not for you to know. It's not for you to know. Don't you hate when your parents say that? Right? It's not for you. You don't need to know that. You don't need to know anything about that. Right? That's what Jesus said here. It's not for you to know the times or the seasons, which the Father has put in his own power. He didn't say, no, Israel's not going to get the kingdom that you think is a physical earthly kingdom. He didn't say that. He didn't explain and say, guys, you're missing it. You're missing it again. Remember in his earthly ministry when the Pharisees and even his disciples didn't get the message, they said, you're so hard-hearted. You're so hard of hearing. You know, you're so dense. He would just kind of complain at them. He doesn't do that here in Acts 1:7. Doesn't say, you guys have been with me for 40 days, don't you know? He says, it's not for you to know the times or the seasons. Why isn't it for them to know? Because when you're talking about the future things, you're talking about the kingdom's return, the fulfillment of prophecy. This is the Father's role. The Father hath put in his own power. This is why, by the way, Jesus in his earthly ministry, he never reveals the things that the Father has, it's his authority to perform. Jesus preached in his earthly ministry to Israel only those things that he was to preach to Israel. Romans 15:8 says to confirm the promises made to the fathers according to the truth of God. He was not to tell them the day and the hour. It was not for him to know. It was not for them to know, right? Jesus was God. The Son of God knew. Okay, it was not for the Son of Man being sent to man to preach, to know. It's not for these disciples to know the times or the seasons. It's the Father that knows. Jesus says, I and the Father are one. Okay, so it wasn't for them to know. What an amazing statement to make. When people claim that the apostles here are just ignorant and that really there is no literal kingdom to Israel, they err. They not only make a mockery of Luke 24:45 and Acts 1 verse 3, but they put themselves here in Acts 1, putting themselves in an impossible position to perform a kingdom ministry that they just simply can't. Perform a ministry of power by the Holy Ghost that they simply can't. Okay? Matthew 5, verse 5, Jesus, didn't he say that the meek shall inherit the earth? Didn't he teach them to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven? Okay? In Jeremiah 23, it says there'll be a righteous branch who will judge the earth. Isaiah 9:6, it says he'll set up a kingdom and his throne will be all around the earth and all around the world, okay? In Luke 1:68-75, Zacharias prophesies with the Holy Ghost and he says that he's going to fulfill the promises made to our fathers so that we can dwell in the land without fear and serve God in the land, right? So Zacharias, with the Holy Spirit, is talking about a physical kingdom. And to say that they all didn't know that, they were just ignorant and misunderstood it, and it was really a spiritual kingdom, it's rejecting the scriptures, folks. All throughout the Bible, it talks about a physical, earthly kingdom, and the apostles know how that's going to come. It's going to come through this guy who's the Messiah. He's the king. And the only question is, will you do it now? Or is it going to be later? Okay. Jesus says it's not for you to know. You go preach and offer this kingdom to Israel, and you tell them to repent. Okay. This is exactly what Peter preaches in Acts 3 when he says, repent so that the times of restitution, the kingdom can come. Okay. Now, we can, in hindsight, look back and know the answer to this question only because it's been 2,000 years, right? We know the answer was no. God the Father did not institute the kingdom to Israel in the last 2,000 years. In fact, the book of Acts itself contains the answer in Acts 28:28. When Paul, in Rome, says to Jews, salvation is taken from you. Salvation's going to the Gentiles, and they're going to hear it. Him saying that is saying Israel's not getting the kingdom. That's essentially what he's saying. Israel's not getting it. But they didn't know that in Acts 1 verse 6 yet. They didn't know it yet. There's events that have to transpire before that happens. Okay? That's what the book of Acts is about. And so we see in Acts 1 verse 8, then the final verse we'll cover tonight, Acts 1 verse 8, Jesus says, it's not for you to know, but ye shall receive power. You will receive knowledge. The Holy Spirit does not give them knowledge of the mystery. He gives them knowledge of their preaching in the kingdom, what Christ wants them to say. But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Oh, by the way, I should not leave verse 7 before I mention this one thing. There are some people who say that Christ did not know the mystery at all in Acts 1 verse 7. Okay? And if he did not know the mystery, then why in the world didn't he explain this to the apostles? Why didn't he explain to the apostles that, yeah, the kingdom's going to come soon if they accept it, right? Instead, he gives them this non-answer. It's not for you to know, right? He didn't say no. He didn't say yes. It's not that he's ignorant. He says it's not for you to know, okay? Jesus knows that there's something coming. Him being God knows, as Isaiah says, the end from the beginning, right? He knows, according to prophecy, Israel had to fall, right? There's events that have to happen in Israel's history. They have to fall. Paul explains that in Romans 11. He says, well, it's according to prophecy that Israel fell. It was according to mystery that salvation can go without Israel during their fall. That was the mystery, okay? But Jesus, knowing prophecy, Revelation says the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy, or the other way around, the spirit of Jesus is the testimony of prophecy. And Jesus knows then that Israel's going to reject him, right? Just like he knew when he came to the earth that they would crucify him. He knew that. How did he know that? It's been prophesied already. It was spoken about in the law, Psalms, and the prophets concerning him, right? And he's going to know that they're going to reject him here too in Acts 7. But he doesn't tell the disciples, guys, just play along, would you? He says, it's not for you to know. You go preach the kingdom, right? And that's what they do. Anyway, Acts 1 verse 8, ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. This is similar, it sounds like, to the commissions in Matthew 28 where he says, go to all nations. And in Mark 16, he says, go and preach everywhere. Okay, Luke 24, it says, begin in Jerusalem. And this is what he says in Acts 1, verse 8. He says, you need to start in Jerusalem, and then in Judea, and then Samaria, and the most part of the earth. Well, what's the difference between these locations? Well, you look at your map, and you know that Jerusalem is a city. Judea is those tribes around the city. Samaria is the land where those 10 tribes lived around, you know, in Israel. So with Samaria and Judea and Jerusalem, you have the land of Israel, the country of Israel there. The Samaritan woman was a Jew. Half Jew, but a Jew. She was of the lineage of the Hebrews, okay? The uttermost parts of the world, that's the Gentiles out here. And before the uttermost parts of the world get the message, Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria got to get it. And in that order, by the way, okay? Which this tells us something. Most people read that verse and they spiritualize it and say, well, this is how we do ministry. You start where your hometown is in Greentown, and then you expand. You know, maybe we'll start in Indianapolis. Then you expand to Indiana, then the Midwest, and then America, and then the world. You know, this is how we do it. Great Commission, all around the world. Well, that's not what Jesus is saying here. He's talking about prophecy in a coming kingdom, and the kingdom can only come to Jerusalem, right? The kingdom can only come there. Look at Isaiah 59. I think the dispensational Bible study in the 1800s really increased the, increased the study of prophecy. And yet, people nowadays don't study it as much as they should. And I'm going to stick my foot in my mouth here because I don't know the chapter that this verse is in. It's not 59. Well, let's turn to 66. Isaiah 66, verse 18. Here's another one. Isaiah 66, verse 18. Isaiah 66 is prophesying about the kingdom to Israel. And this is just one of many. There's another verse in 59. It's not on my outline or another place in Isaiah. I'll get to you next week. Isaiah 66, verse 18 is where the kingdom has come to Israel, okay, and Christ is there, the king is there. And Isaiah 66 describes this kingdom set up in Israel and all the nations coming to it. And verse 18 says, I know their works and their thoughts. It shall come that I will gather all nations and tongues, and they shall come and see my glory. And I will set a sign among them, and they will send those that escape of them unto the nations, to Tarshish and to Paul. And it says, they'll come and declare my glory among the Gentiles. People are going to come to a place. Where are they going to see the glory of God? Well, you read up in Isaiah 66, where they're going to is verse 13. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. Okay, in Zion is God's glory. It says that over and over again in Isaiah. Jerusalem is where God's glory is at. Israel is where salvation is at. The prophecies say the kingdom and salvation and the glory of God is found in Israel. Zechariah talks about Gentiles grabbing the coattails of a Jew and saying, take us to Israel, take us to Jerusalem so we can see your king. Okay, that's the prophecies. So it's important that Jesus says, stay in Jerusalem to receive power, then preach in Jerusalem, then Judea and Samaria, and then the innermost parts of the world. Because salvation is said to come to Israel. It is contrary to prophecy to say that the kingdom is not in Israel, but in the other parts of the world. To say that we Gentiles, as part of the church in Indiana, represent the kingdom, and that Israel today does not have it, is contrary to the prophecies. You understand? Where do you find that in the Bible? Nowhere in Israel's history. Nowhere in Israel's prophecy. You only find that in the mystery. How can Gentiles be saved and not Jews? As far as their nation. That's a mystery. Romans 11:25 says that this mystery is that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of Gentiles become in. The blindness occurs, yet salvation is still preached. That's the mystery. Okay, how that can be. So my point in just reading through Isaiah 66, and I promised you other verses next week, so hold me to that. But is in Acts 1 verse 8 when Jesus says, You'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria. There's a prophetic reason for that. So we can't spiritualize that. We can't say that's talking about Greentown. There's a prophetic reason why they needed to be in Jerusalem and get there first. And by the way, that is why after Jerusalem rejects the apostles, the next thing God does is calls an apostle to the Gentiles. You ever think about that? People read the book of Acts and say, well, this is actually an outline of the book of Acts because they start in Jerusalem in Acts 2, verse 7, and then they go to Samaria in Acts 8, or Judea, you know, in Samaria in Acts 8, and then they go to the uttermost parts of the world with Paul. So it's really just an outline of the book of Acts. And I say, no, it's baloney. That's what that is, okay? Because everywhere they go, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the world, all the Jews in the book of Acts reject salvation, right? They don't accept it. They reject it. The only time we see anyone receiving salvation, it's in Paul's epistles as he's preaching to Gentiles, the mystery of Christ. Okay, salvation by grace through faith, not according to the law, not according to Israel. So it's not a summary of the book of Acts. If anything, the summary is that Israel rejects it, but that's not what Jesus intends here. He intends for them to receive it. And I just explained to you how prophecy required Jerusalem and Judea be on board, Israel be on board. And as soon as Jerusalem in Acts 7 rejects salvation through the apostles, through Stephen, through Peter, then the next thing God does is raises up Saul as Paul and calls him, I'm sending you to the Gentiles to preach salvation because they have rejected the prophetic purpose. Because we can't go even to Judea without Jerusalem. We can't go to Samaria without Jerusalem. We definitely can't go to the Gentiles without Jerusalem to fulfill this kingdom on the earth. So as soon as Jerusalem rejects him, Paul's called. And he says, Paul, go to the Gentiles. And so from that point forward, you have Paul going to Jews, yes, but he's preaching to them, look, guys, you know, here's salvation. Here's your last hope. It's already been rejected in Jerusalem, right? We'll cover that as we get to those chapters, okay? What's missing from Acts 1, verse 8, this commission of receiving power in the Holy Ghost is the cross of Christ, is the gospel, the grace of God, is the mystery, is the one body. None of that's in Acts 1, verse 8. It's not there. Where is our pattern, is what I ask. It's not in Acts 1, okay? You don't find it until Christ reveals the dispensation of grace. Any questions about Acts 1 through 8? Man, there's a lot of material in there. Yeah. Well, let's look at 1 Thessalonians 5. You're right. Jesus actually tells them times and seasons in Matthew 24. He tells them times and seasons in his ministry. Tells him to watch. He's answering here the specific question of, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? That's the thing that he says, it's not for you to know. Okay, will you at this time restore the kingdom? It's not for you to know that. In fact, it was dependent upon Israel's receiving their message or not. What they were told to watch for were these signs of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, okay, of the tribulation. Matthew 24, the question posed to Jesus was, when he said this temple will be destroyed, he says, when will this happen and when's the end of the world? Right, that's what they were asking. And Jesus gives them these signs. Here's the sign of the end of the world. Here's the sign of my coming. You know, watch for these things. I need to look for the coming kingdom. But looking for it and watching for it, it's different than saying, hey, are you doing it now? You know, if I say, you know, you got to wait for me to, you know, I'm going to give you something. You just got to wait for it. Right, just wait for it. Look for it. Hope for it. I'm going to give it to you. You say, you're going to give it to me now? Well, I'm not going to tell you when I'm going to give it to you. I'm not going to tell you the date and the hour. I'm not going to tell you if it's going to happen now. You got to wait for it. You look for it. Here's the signs. You'll know by looking at these signs if it's going to happen soon. Right? It's going to happen. That's a different type of thing. So he gave them signs to look for, and they can know the time and the season according to prophecy. Just like I explained earlier, they knew where they were at in the prophetic timeline based on these events that needed to happen. His ascension, the Holy Spirit coming down, things like that. But there was kind of a question on whether Christ was going to come, immediately, you know, or whether Israel was going to receive the message or whether they're going to reject it. You know, what would happen there? So this is kind of the question that they're having. Will you at this time restore the kingdom? You know, it's not for them to know that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so. I think you're right to question that, though. The times and seasons there do refer to, in prophecy, there were times in which they lived, the times of the Gentiles. There were seasons in which they can tell one season from another according to prophecy and what they're in. Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5 something a little different. He doesn't say that same thing. He says, there's no need that I write unto you regarding the times and seasons. There's no need. The saying, it's not for you to know, is different than there's no need. You know, I mean, these were prophetic people who are living in prophecy. They wanted to know, and it could be needful. You know, of course, Jesus said they didn't, you know, it was not for them to know. Paul says there's no need for you to know about the times and seasons. So it's a totally different orientation. Whereas Peter preaches in Acts 2, you know, the prophecies say there's this sign's going to happen and this sign's going to happen, right? Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 5, you have no need even to have that. I mean, because you're not part of that. He says you're not walking in the darkness that way. You're short of light. So there's a difference in the way Paul uses it. But it's a good question. Any comments?
I have an unrelated comment.
Yeah.
We're ready to move on.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to clarify in Acts 1:7, when Jesus gives that answer, and you said that, you know, when Jesus came to earth, that he knew he was going to be crucified, he knew what was going to happen, just like he knew things were to happen yet in the future, that he needed to give a non-answer to them when they asked this question. He didn't know those things just because they were in scriptures or they were prophesied about. He knew those things because he was God.
Yeah.
Right. I wanted to clarify that. It wasn't just because they were in the scriptures and that he read them in the scriptures and learned that that's what it was going to be. I mean, he knew it despite the fact that it was in the scriptures. He knew it because he was God.
Yeah, that's right. Yep. Yep. There are things that God does not reveal. Jesus says here, it's because the Father hath put in his own power. That means it's his power, his authority, his choice to make this thing happen or not, you know. So he's going to bring the kingdom in according to his grace. And we learn that according to the mystery that, you know, Peter says in 2 Peter, that he's delayed his coming because of his long suffering and his grace. And so God had made a choice, and we know from before the world began, to show his mercy and his grace to the world, even when they did reject him. You know, so according to prophecy, you know, if they rejected him, the wrath should have come in the kingdom. If they would have accepted him, the kingdom would have come. Right? This was what happened according to prophecy. We know according to the mystery what God had purposed was that when they rejected him, he would show grace. And so either way, there's this postponement. Whether they accepted it or didn't, there had to be this revelation of the mystery. And so I think this is what Jesus is referring to here, which I see as proof that he knew the mystery. That's what I was trying to explain earlier, that he knew that there would be an interruption in the prophetic times. It was not for them to know because it wasn't for them to do, to preach that. And that's what I was trying to say too. It wasn't something that God had given them to preach. The same way Jesus, it wasn't given him to preach the mystery when he was on earth. He knew it. That wasn't what he came to preach. You know. Yeah.
It's not for them. So that wasn't part of their message.
Yep, that wasn't for them to know. Yeah. Yeah. So I'm sending you to cook breakfast. I'm sending you to clean the bathroom, you know, and you're going to say, well, how do you cook breakfast? It's not for you to know that. It's for her to know that. It's for you to clean, you know. I mean, it doesn't matter whether you know or not. Well, it's kind of irrelevant, but it's not for you to know. You know, it's your responsibility to do this. So that's what he's doing there. You know, he sends them with this commission. They ask, will you at this time? He says, it's not for you to know. You know. But the important thing there is I think that he's not telling them no, and which is what a lot of theologians say, that Jesus knew that it was a spiritual kingdom. They thought it was a physical kingdom. And so when they asked the question, they were displaying their ignorance a prophecy, and Jesus was supposed to, or he should have explained to them that it was not a literal kingdom that was happening, and actually the kingdom was happening now. The amillennials say that the kingdom, spiritual kingdom, came when Christ died. Christ died and rose from the dead. The kingdom comes. We're living in the kingdom. Well, if that's true, then why they ask this question? And if it's true, why didn't Jesus say, yes, the kingdom's here now? You know, he didn't. Or why didn't he say, it'll come with the Spirit? You know, that's not what he said. So this issue with the kingdom come, it's not yet. They weren't living in the kingdom in Acts 2. You know, so, yeah. Any other questions? Good stuff. Yeah, we'll talk more. We're going to do some end time lessons on Sundays in the weeks to come. And, you know, that's a big difference between these guys' position and our position, where they had things to look for. And so they wanted to know more. You know, it's like people today who are looking for signs, and they want more information. They want to pull this from the Bible, from prophecy, to see if they can find out more things happening. And so the same thing with them. They had times and seasons to measure. We have none. Okay, and so dispensationalists have taught in the past couple hundred years and in the history that we believe in the imminent return of the Lord Jesus Christ. The word imminent means that there's nothing that has to happen between now and when the Lord comes. According to prophecy, the Lord would come and could come whenever he wanted to come, but things had to happen before he came. Like, there was prophetic events that had to happen before he came. So it was not imminent. It was not that there was nothing in between. There were things that had to happen, and then he would come. Well, we preach the imminent return. That is, there's nothing that needs to happen before he's come. You know, and so some folks who think that there's signs of the rapture, I mean, it's just nonsense. The rapture is a mystery teaching, and there's nothing that has to happen according to prophecy for that to occur. You know, the Lord will decide when he returns for the church. You know, these guys, there were things that had to happen, and so it was legitimate for them to ask that kind of question. You know, when? Anything else? All right, Lord, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for the work of the Spirit that you give us to seal us to the day of redemption and to teach us your word. I pray that we would learn better how to rightly divide it so that we can apply those passages you've given to us, to follow your instructions, to be stronger at it so that we can convince and persuade and preach others to be saved and to do your work and to be unashamed at doing so. We thank you, Lord, for the folks who come out, and the people who are part of your body, that we can learn and grow together. Amen. Thank you, folks.